Okay, there we go. Oh. All right, let me just tell you. Do you have Rat Talk saved on your Facebook?
You say something.
Yeah, well, I was just saying, because I was trying to tag you in this post, but it's not letting me.
Wait, you're trying to tag the my official account, my personal Facebook, or you're talking about the Satanic Panic Show official Facebook?
Both, actually.
you might have some trouble with my personal, because like I have that one set to private. The Satanic Panic Show one, that's public. Anyone can tag that one.
All right, let's try this again.
Yeah, Twitter's public too, so yeah, got that one all together.
Oh shit, I'm not even going live on Twitter. I didn't even fucking realize that. Oh, god damn it. All right, whatever. Let's start this fucking show. All right.
All hail, rap motherfuckers, get back, store rails. Kick back with a six pack, hell, he gon' do what he want, leave another zip pale. A podcast level's far beyond that. This ain't no bullshit, it's marsh pits and all that. Real talk for the steel, got tasty. Rat sticks, bitches on your faces. Gone ape shit, blaze it and take it in. Rat talks, crack rolls and gin. Metalheads unite with a grin. Goddamn master man, that's real shit now. So open up your mind to smoke a bowl. A bunch of potheads getting stoned, you know how it go. It's the new show on the block, 100% uncut, rock top.
Oh shit, everybody, it's another episode of Rat Talk. Alright, good, I feel good now. Everything's working again. Last Rat Talk episode, everything was not working. I was really pissed.
We've all had those days.
I know, man, and it really fucking sucked, so I'm glad that everything's working now. We are back full force, and in this episode of Rat Talk, I've got the one, the only, the host of the Satanic Panic Show, which is a family member over here at Famcast Media, Kwame Wakan. Is that how you say it, right? Kwame Wakan?
You pronounced it perfectly right off the bat.
See, I always fuck up with fucking cool names. Shit, like these fucking weird spelling names are so goddamn cool, you know.
I've heard it pronounced so many different ways, and also I just noticed right now on my screen that I have it spelled wrong because the K key doesn't exactly work.
Oh shit!
I it took. It was like that last podcast too, and I didn't even realize that either.
Oh, it was the same during the holiday special?
Yep, for the holiday special.
Oh my god. Nobody even noticed. Well, I mean, shit, you couldn't even really see what was going on the screen anyway. There's so many people that show, man. It was a whole lot. I mean, but yes, you are a member of the Famcast Media Network. So I'm glad that I'm finally able to have you on the show, man. Like, it's fucking, it's awesome.
It's great to be here.
And I mean, okay, so let's talk about your show for a little bit then. Like, what's, go ahead and give us a synopsis of it. What's the show to you?
Basically, the way I started off Satanic Panic, it was basically as a way to educate people about Satanism. I was getting a lot of requests about it. A lot of people were accusing Satanists of being like these devil worshippers, these evil people and whatnot. So I basically started that as a way to debunk a lot of that stuff. And then I also wanted to use it as a way to, you know, platform, you know, smaller and more independent metal artists. Because, you know, the way I see, you know, metal isn't really played on the radio as much as it should be. You know, a lot of the heavy metal stations that, you know, used to exist when I was a kid no longer exist. Even XM Liquid Metal, like they're now branching off and now they're playing like trap metal and fusion metal and this and that and the other. I didn't feel like independent artists were getting the exposure that they ought to get. So I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna just let everyone know my opinions on certain bands.
I'm sorry. It was kind of like the scene was changing, but like there were still these bands that were coming up in this specific genre. And it was like, the outlets that they did have are now expanding and like going into other shit where it was taking away their airtime for them.
Yep.
And yeah, and kind of just there to boom, pick up the slack.
And then not only that, but like it's even with this whole COVID shit, like a lot of places that, you know, used to do shows for, you know, metalheads and, you know, punk bands, small bands like that, a lot of them are going permanently closed now. So the only way people can really know is through social media now.
Yeah. 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 And so, you know, going, being that outlet now, and then you also have like a really good premise to your show and everything. Like you do talk about the headlines and everything, but the way you do it is a little better than the way we can pull it off.
I need to put a little bit more work and effort into it. I have to admit, because, you know, lately I've been slacking. Although I have done like a few more, I'm kind of guilty of, you know, how should I say this, of branching out too, because not too long ago, I was followed by an artist. I don't want to reveal who he is just yet.
Okay.
But he's a country artist, and I'm like, is he lost or something? Like, I didn't think that I would be, you know, popular among country musicians, but apparently this person followed me, and then another person followed me, and then they ended up commenting on, like, two of my videos. I'm like, all right, now I have country fans watching my videos. So I'm like, you know what? This person is pretty famous. He has a blue check mark next to his name on Twitter. I might as well review him as an artist. And I got, it's like 70% done. I just have to edit and all that. So,
you know, I feel like that's a side effect though of creating a show and like, yeah, and branding yourself as someone who is just like, you know, like, yeah, this is what I want to talk about for you. I mean, for you, it shows your open-mindedness, I guess, you know, because yeah, I mean, again, I don't want to say that you're branching out, like, you know, like, yeah, kicking.
Yeah, I'm not kicking any of the bands to the curb. I'm still going to be a heavy metal YouTuber, a heavy metal podcaster. I'm still going to collect albums and buy merch like everyone else.
I mean, okay, so where did the inspiration come from? I mean, we know why, like, that was your idea of creating the show and everything, but I mean, where did well, what's your history with like podcasts and everything? Like, what inspired you to get started?
Well, to be honest, this was actually my first time doing it. I think prior before I even started calling it the Satanic Panic Show, I was just, you know, live streaming on Facebook to like my friends and whatnot. And like literally like either once a week or once every couple weeks, I would just do a live stream for like about an hour, and I would just have people commenting, suggesting things to talk about. like I said, I literally have like no podcasting or YouTube experience. I literally just learned how to do most of this stuff over the past 2 years. Just figured out how to use, you know, certain video editing tools, certain audio editing tools. So yeah, but yeah, I never really done this before. I'm just winging it and winging it like right off the bat.
Oh shit. I mean, but okay.
I mean, you can kind of tell because it's kind of like on my earlier episode, you have like bad audio quality. I wasn't using Phantom Power at the moment. I was still using the USB port. I mean, not the USB port, the microphone port that was plugged into my motherboard, and that's pretty shitty.
But I mean, so you kind of just naturally fell into this, you know? Like, for me, I'm a real big comedy fan. So like I listen to stand up and everything, and like I followed a lot of people, and podcast is basically where, you know, I can always listen to them every single day. So that was kind of like mine. But you were saying that you were doing live streams already, like already talking about your opinions on things, and like it was more of a natural entryway for you. And you, I mean, really all you did different was just pick up some equipment and start recording it.
Yeah, that was basically it. Like, I honestly didn't even think that many people would watch it. Like, I'm still surprised that, you know, some of my videos and episodes get like thousands of views. I'm like, how did this get like 2,000 views in one day? And then I was checking my statistics. Apparently, since I've been active, I've gotten at least 19,000 views on YouTube. And I'm like, that's weird, because like. I'm just a small YouTuber, only 130 subscribers, and then all these views coming in. And then Facebook, that's even, I've gotten even more views on Facebook, to be honest. People are sharing a lot of my band reviews. People are sharing a lot of my, you know, opinionated reviews. People are sharing, like, I've even got one of the high priestesses of a satanic temple to retweet some of my Satanist videos. So I'm like, all right, well, people are listening, so I guess I must be doing something right.
Well, okay, then that might have something to do with you know, your upbringing. So like, where have you gone to school? Where are you from? Like, obviously, I'm just gonna spitball this here. You lived overseas for a while. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, my parents are like,
you talk like such an American, you know.
I to be honest, I've been trying to find my natural voice for a while. Like when I like the way I'm speaking right now is like, this is technically my presenter voice. Mm-hmm. But the thing is, when I talk naturally, everyone says it sounds weird. And then when I talk like this, everyone else says it sounds weird. So I'm like, all right, well, I'm damned if I do, I'm damned if I don't. So I'm like, all right, so I speak, try to Americanize my voice a little bit. And then like, they're like, oh, it sounds so fake. So then I tried to, you know, to make it sound a lot more, you know, presentable, like, you know, the received pronunciation. And they're like, oh, well, that your accent sounds so weird, sounds so fake. I'm like, fuck it. I might as well just not talk at all.
Yeah, right. Yeah, like exactly like you said, damned if you do, damned if you don't. Like, that's, and you know what? I can't really, I mean.
But yeah, but back to what you said about upbringing. Yeah, my mother is Italian and Native American, and my father is African and English. So it's so like African English, and I think a little bit of Bajan.
Where did they meet?
Gosh, I'm not exactly sure, because like my father's been living in the United States for quite a long time, since since like the 60s or something like that.
Oh, wow.
Mother was born here, because like my grandmother is Lenape Indian. Mm-hmm. Lenape Native American, and I think one of my great grandparents is Italian, so I'm like all mixed up, to be honest.
Okay, so you were born here then?
Yep. Wow. 1994.
Man, see, that's a trip. It's 90, it was just
the 90s, baby.
So I'm guessing, so your dad didn't drop the accent, obviously.
He kind of Americanized it a little bit, but it sounds a lot better than mine.
His American accent. So okay, so well, could you, I guess basically what I'm trying to get at it is like, where does that accent come from? Like, did you grow up over, like, did you go to school overseas or anything? Like, are you from...
Well, I live around like a lot of, you know, I guess you could say immigrants. So I literally everyone had an accent growing up. The
Okay.
town that I went to preschool shortly, what was it like? About an hour away from Princeton. And like basically two of the teachers had an accent there, like all of the kids, you know, they came from all over. I had two other people I know that came from, I think, Croydon, and then like five other kids I knew, they came from the islands. So like you know, I guess you could say in UK English is a lot different than, you know, American English. So the way we spelled
Yeah.
words, the way we pronounced words. I mean, I still spell and pronounce the words the same way. Like, I know you spell. I don't want to get into this again, but the whole aluminum and aluminium thing that we did in the holiday special.
It's funny. I was gonna bring that up too. I was like, okay, because it was following that line, but yeah, okay. So wait, it's spelled differently? I didn't even realize that. I mean, because yeah, the spelling means a lot, you know.
Yes, yeah, we the thing is, like, I notice in a lot of, you know, Americanized books, like, they don't spell words with you anymore. Like, the word neighbor is spelled with a U, armor is spelled with a U, color is spelled with a U, program that's spelled with an extra M and an extra E. Gosh, I'm trying to think of all the other things that we spelled. Oh, tire, because I have to get my tires replaced tomorrow. Tire is spelled with a Y instead of an I. So, but yeah, that's one of the things I got when I was in school. Like, everyone was like, "Oh, Kwame, where exactly are you from?" Because, you know, like, I mean, your words are spelled correctly, but they're not spelled the way anyone else spells them.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was getting that all throughout both primary school and in college. So.
Man, so that's a trip. So that accent literally is from just growing up here and having a I guess, yeah, like your
I mean,
dad.
it's. I mean, don't get me wrong. I pronounce words like strangely though, because like being that I live in New Jersey, everyone has like an, I guess you can say, a New Jersey accent. So
Yeah.
sometimes people, I pronounce the word water instead of water. So,
No, believe it.
and then not only that, but then I don't even notice when I'm doing it. But sometimes I code switch every now and then. So I'm like, all right, well, I pronounce. I'm around this way when I'm around my family. And then I'm completely different when I'm around my coworkers and my friends and whatnot.
Yeah, no, I was gonna say I talked to D enough to know I didn't know exactly what the New Jersey accent sounds like.
Yeah.
I could pick it up, dude, eventually. All right, man. So this I mean, that's a fucking trip, dude. Like, you're blowing my mind right now. Like, I thought you were like, oh yeah, I was born in England and my father I came here when I was like five or whatever.
Yeah, I'm just an English guy living in the United States, completely lost.
Well, I mean, and then it's translating to such good content, man. Like, you are basically one of our best shows that we have on, you know, Famcast Media for sure. And you have such a good
No, I think it was D, because it was actually D that got me, like, kind of inducted me into, you know, Famcast Media. So
he
I
sucked.
mean, wouldn't I oh, yeah it wouldn't yeah D probably has the best show, I'd say, in my honest opinion. I mean, don't I mean no, that's no insult to you, because I love your show too.
No. Yeah, totally. I get it, man. Because yeah, you're right, dude. Because yeah. D is the he's the father of Famcast for sure. Like, he's the one that's kind of Gal. Basically, he did round us all up and put us, brand us and everything. And but yeah, no, man. I like your show is like one of the best. It is one of the best ones, like on paper and in quality too. Like the content that you have out there, man, it's good. And you have your niche of
I can improve a lot. I still think there's a lot of room for improvement. Like I said, I'm working on it.
and you know what though that when you say that and everything, but like I'm trying to follow your lead. Like, oh shit, like, see, I need to have something like a like you know like something to focus on, like Kwame does on his shows whenever he puts them out and everything. So, like, I mean, dude, the better you get, the better I get. So, of course, man, like, I feel like that's what we should be doing, is just building up on each other. So I'm very honored to have you on the show finally. I mean, I should have done this a long time ago, but I didn't feel worthy. I'm not worthy. We're not
worthy. I didn't even know you were a fan of Wayne's World either.
Oh, dude, I fucking love the class. I was actually.
But then again, what metalhead isn't a fan of Wayne's World?
Yeah, exactly, dude. I was Wayne for Halloween 1 year, man. I could totally pull it off, dude.
Yo, that was one sick Halloween. That would have been one sick Halloween costume. I'm not gonna lie,
dude. I fucking lost the hat too. I have no idea where my hat is, but well, I'll fucking find it. I'll find it and I'll wear it just for you, man. But okay, so you are like you are a Satanist. Like that's what the whole show was about. Like you said, like you were there debunking.
Yeah, I kind of named it Satanic Panic, basically, you know, ironically, as a way, you know, it was named after, you know, the Satanic Panic movement in the 1980s, where basically everyone was claiming that Satanists were part of the government and, you know, certain religious organizations, the police force.
Well, I mean, and that, you know, wasn't the Illuminati also like that was like very still like, yeah, if you're a Satanist.
Yep, Illuminati and all that other stuff, you know, basically it's like they took some Alex Jones conspiracy theories and, you know, some sort of, I guess you could say, anti-Semitic conspiracy theories and basically the lowest common denominator and just pinned everything on Satanists.
Yeah.
And my whole thing is like, well, the Satanic Panic movement is like, well, what's the best way I can put this? It's basically, you know, this irrational fear. And my thing is like, I named it ironically because, you know, I'm a Satanist. I'm disproving all these stereotypes about Satanists. You know, I mean, I hate to put the race card into it, but, you know, I'm a black dude. So like most people are like, oh, well, Satanists are racist and this and that and the other. And I'm like, they see this black dude on YouTube and he's a Satanist and, you know, he's getting along well with everyone else. Yeah. So. But yeah, it was basically just to dispel all of the myths about Satanism. Let everyone know that there's really nothing to be afraid about. We don't worship the devil. We don't sacrifice children or animals. And we don't. We're just not like the way everyone else projects us to be.
All right. So then what was your introduction to Satan and Satanism and everything? Like, did it start with heavy metal music? Like everybody says, like,
actually it didn't start with heavy metal. I was actually still a Christian. Oh, I missed that.
Yeah, go for it. I was just saying like, you know, everyone says like, oh, if you listen to heavy metal, then you're a Satanist, blah, blah, blah. Like,
yeah, it didn't even lead for, it didn't even start from heavy metal with me. I was a Christian. I was actually raised in a church. My family's religious. My uncle, you know, he was a pastor for, you know, a very long time. That was until he passed away in 2010. But I was very involved in the church. I sang in the church choir. You know, I was, you know, I basically would meet with the pastor every Sunday. I went to Sunday school. I was heavily involved in, you know, the youth ministry.
You keep yourself.
I was like drunk off of Jesus juice.
Oh no.
And I didn't really become skeptical of religion until it was shortly after my uncle had passed away in 2010. I'm like, he was a man of God. He died of cancer. I was really upset about it. And but I still, you know, remained, you know, active in the church. You know, still read the Bible every night, still went to church every Sunday. But, you know, the way, seeing how so many Christians were behaving, you know, they would say one thing, they would act one way when they're in church. And then when church is over and the doors open up and they go out in the streets, they would act completely different. You know, you would see Christians talking about people for example, like the whole LGBTQ thing. You would have all these Christians talking all this crap about people in the LGBTQ community. And then they would leave church and they're going around sleeping with every Tom, Dick and Harry. You know, they're just so much lies and hypocrisy in the church. Yeah. And then I actually started reading the Bible and then like actually reading it, not like reading it as a kid, but reading it as, you know, from a skeptical perspective.
Yeah.
You see so much contradictory, so much violence, and you're like, Christians aren't even acting the way that Jesus told them to act. They're just acting, they're just cherry picking and doing whatever the hell that they want. And then they think that if they repent at the last moment, then they're going to go up into heaven. And yeah, they think that that makes them a good person. It doesn't. Yeah, I don't know.
No. Yeah, you're absolutely right, dude. Because that's, I wasn't as involved in the church as far as, you know, like as far as that, like going, you know, to choir and like going every Sunday and everything. But like, I did talk, like I would have meetings with the priest and everything. I did my sacrament. Like, I grew up Catholic, so that's, you know, yeah, I did like my sacraments and everything. I went to the, not, it wasn't Sunday school, but it was something like that. And like, yeah, man, like the people there and like my experience, like my whole experience was just like, man, like this is yeah, like it's so hypocritical. It's so hypocritical and fake. And like these people aren't good people, you know. Like,
yep.
I mean, but
well, I'm not going to lie. The Catholic Church is somewhat tolerable. I think the most tolerable religion, in my honest opinion, would be the Anglican Church. But then again, we did break away from the Catholic Church many, many centuries ago. So.
yeah. Exactly. I mean, it wasn't. That's why. Like, it wasn't that bad. But like. I was pretty involved in church and everything. Like I was in, I didn't do the choir or anything, but I was like in the plays. Like we would reenact the Stations of the Cross, or like, you know, there was a whole huge like Christmas act out that we did of like the angel coming down and shit like that. And yeah, I was actually really, I was like, okay, so in our Christmas thing, the main, like the big ooh ah look at me moment was the Archangel Gabriel, because like we had like a big old stand and everything. He had a whole like he had a whole set of lines and all of that. And my brother and I, both of us, yeah, Ryan and I were both the Archangel Gabriel. And then for the Stations of the Cross, reacting those, both he and I were also the Jesus, you know, like we were, like, people in the church knew who we were. But we were like some real, like we were the bad kids, dude. Like we said fuck and everything. Like we talked about smoking, like sneaking off and smoking weed and stuff. Like, yeah, like the shit that we did, and like, oh man,
the devil's shit. Lettuce,
dude. That's why, dude, man. Catholic girls are fucking, oh, really, just yeah, like the Catholic school girls and everything that were there. Woo. Mm-hmm. Got into some trouble, man.
I guess the rumors really are true. I saw that once in Boys in the Hood, but I never actually believed it until, you know, I became 21 and I started, you know, meeting all these different women. I'm like, gosh, it really is true. These Catholic girls really are pretty wild.
Yeah, man. It's fucking nuts. So you did the whole church thing, like you were very devout, and then once you started reading the Bible from a skeptical perspective, that's when you're like, oh shit, like so what led like towards Satanism? Like, was it just to spite the church and the way you're growing up, like just to be like,
well, actually not a, oh you can finish.
I'm just gonna go the exact opposite of that.
Not exactly. I guess you can say around 19 is when I officially had stopped going to church. Basically, I was getting more involved into, you know, history, you know, Afrocentrism, you know, how basically Christianity was brought to Africa and how it was, you know, used to, you know, make black people more servile. So I'm like, the rest of that, I became, I guess you can say I became a, I was a lapsed Christian for like 19 to 20. And then from 20 to 21, I was just a hardcore atheist. Like I was not just atheist as in I don't believe in God, but I was like anti-theist. I'm like, religion is bad. Religion is responsible for this and that and the other. Religion, you know, is a way to, you know, control the thoughts and mind process of, you know, people in the black community, because I'm not sure if you've noticed this, but if, I mean, you probably won't have experience in this, but if you're black and you tell somebody that you don't believe in God, they look at you as if like you're an alien from another planet, like you've said something like so wrong and so bad.
No, and like saying it to just some random person or like to another black person, because I mean, dude, like it is, yeah, like you're absolutely right. Like it, like God was just shoved, you know, into the community as like, yeah, like salvation and like more servitude and everything. And like, so when you say something like that, are you speaking to another black, like religious black person, or do you mean just to any religious person at all?
Like I'm mostly talking about like other religious black people, because I'm not sure, not too many people know this, but African Americans are the most religiously committed group here in the United States.
Yeah,
around like 70 to 80% of African Americans believe in Christianity, and then the rest either believe in, you know, either Islam or some other traditional religion. And, you know, to be, you know, a black atheist and now a black Satanist, I'm pretty much a minority inside of another minority. So yeah. I get a lot of, you know, weird responses, you know, because I happen to be, you know, a black and not believe in, you know, some sort of deity or some sort of religion.
Yeah, like not believe in something, at least.
Yeah. But yeah, my family overall has been very, you know, kind of accepting. They kind of warmed up to it. Like my mother, not so much. She doesn't like the sigil of Baphomet I have on the back wall. She doesn't like when I wear the necklace. So when my parents, you know, do visit me from time to time, I mean, she allows me to keep the flag up because, you know, it covers like all my, covers up my bookshelf and whatnot. But this, but being that my mom is, you know, she met a man, you know, she's about to get married and whatnot. He doesn't know that I am a Satanist. So I just keep all of that to myself. When I go to family reunions and gatherings, you know, I basically have to, you know, come as a different person. Now on my father's side of the family, my father, he was a little bit upset about it. Like there was a time where he stopped talking to me. He stopped talking to me on Facebook about it because, you know, he was a little bit upset, and I had thought that I originally thought he disowned me, but he was like, oh no, I didn't disown you. It's just that, you know, it was something hard to come by. Don't ever make it feel like I don't love you. You always be my son. I'll always be there for you. Me and my father have a very good relationship.
Yeah.
Even when I speak to him about religious topics and whatnot, sometimes I find himself being a little bit skeptical of the church. You know, he's still religiously committed. You know, he still goes to church. I mean, I still have respect for, you know, my childhood pastors, but I just can't follow religion. I don't really like the way the direction that the church is going.
Yeah.
And I personally think that a person can live a good quality life without having to, you know, believe or worship anything.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. I mean, dude, it's so funny. Like, I can totally relate to everything that you're saying, you know, like it could, because that's exactly how I feel. I feel the same exact way. Like I did the whole Catholic thing and everything. You know, I could have easily gotten to, you know, Satanism and all that and been a devout Satanist like you are and everything. But I just, I didn't, you know, and I settled in it, and that's kind of where I felt it. Like, if I had to choose a religion, it probably would be Satanism, to be honest with you. That's the one that makes more sense to me. It makes me feel like everyone that is involved in it, like they have an understanding that we are all just different people. We're all different human beings and everything, and like we have our opinions. No matter what it is, as long as you're a good person at the end of the day, then it just kind of doesn't fucking matter, you know?
Yeah. Because I think the only way I officially knew about Satanism is because I had literally met another Satanist through, I think it was on my original Twitter before I abandoned that account and mainly started using the Satanic Panic account for my official Twitter now. But another person was like, you know what, you ever hear about Levian Satanism? And I'm like, I know that it's an atheistic religion, but I've never actually like read any of the books or anything like that. So that kind of like piqued my curiosity. Like, all right, well, maybe I should read the book and see what it's about. And I like the whole idea of, you know, rugged individualism, how, you know, you're responsible for your own life, how, you know, no one can tell you what to think. No one can tell you how to think. No one can tell you how to live your life or dictate any or dictate anyone else's life. You know, you live according to your own standard, as long as you don't hurt anyone else and as long as you respect everyone else and their decision.
Amen.
And that's something that you don't really see among other, you know, religions.
Yeah, definitely. And, you know, it's, yeah, that's what that's.
But yeah, ever since that person introduced, suggested that I should research LaVey and Satanists, I'm like, you know what, this is the, I wouldn't say religion, but the philosophy that I want to live by. Like, I'm not part of any, I guess you could say, official satanic church. I consider myself a non-denominational Satanist, because there's ideological differences between all the satanic, I guess you can say, organizations out there.
Mm-hmm.
I have to ask, what organizations are you familiar with? I everyone knows about the Church of Satan, and everyone kind of knows about the Satanic Temple, but I just recently this year found out that there were many other sects of Satanism that I wasn't aware of.
Yeah, no, honestly, I can't say that I was aware of any other one either. Like, I mean, it sounds like a good idea. It kind of sounds like, you know, what Christianity also did, though, too, where it's just like, another branch. So it's a little ironic, but I had no idea that there were other legs of Satanism.
Yeah, but it's mostly based on, you know, ideology and implementation, because the Church of Satan, they tend to stay to themselves. You know, they don't like getting involved into politics or anything like that, whereas the Satanic Temple is seeing that Christians are starting to overstep their boundaries. So what they're doing is they're like, all right, well, if you want to overstep your boundaries, then we're going to overstep our boundaries. You want the Ten Commandments on public property? Well, you know what? We're going to put a statue of Baphomet on public property. And then when Christians start complaining, we're going to be like, hey, we're just following the same law that you set up. We're calling you out on the rule. We're playing by your rules. Yeah. So that's, and basically what they're doing is they're trying to bait Christians into supporting the separation of church and state.
Yeah, exactly.
So I can't really get mad at them for that, because they're like trolling on like level 100, and that's what I like.
Dude, and that statue is sick, man. I've seen it. It's awesome.
But shortly after that, I think it was 2015, I met a chapter head of the Satanic Temple. His name was Damian Bale. And shortly after that, I'm guessing there was ideological differences between him and the founder of the Satanic Temple, Lucian Greaves. So he left and he started his own agency called the United Aspect of Satanism, which is more of a, I guess you could say, a more humanistic version of Satanism. Yeah. Basically, they take every religion has like this one, I guess you can say, deity. Mm-hmm. That is seen as, you know, the evil deity, whether it be Loki, whether it be Baal, whether it be Beelzebub, anything like that. Mm-hmm. And he basically has them set up into different, I guess you can say, different categories. And each category represents certain tenets. Now, I know I'm paraphrasing at this point, because I don't have the book in front of me. Like, for example, the principle of Loki is more like is more like seen as, you know, festive, more of comedy, more of joy, things like that. I really wish I had the book right in front of me. I'm gonna have to dig through my stuff in order to find it. But if you're interested, it's called the Satanic Narratives by Damian Bale. If you ever think you want to read it.
I could probably do a quick search right now. What was it again?
The Satanic Narratives by Damian Bale.
He was the one that you met, this guy.
Which one now?
Damian Bale. Didn't you say that you met him? He's the one that started.
Yeah, it was in 2015 when they were doing the statue reveal in Detroit.
How is Bale found? Just B-A-L-E?
Yeah, B-A-A-L.
B-A-A.
But yeah, he's just had another book that came out, I think, last year called Shit Happens. That one I still have yet to read. I had to buy it as soon as I could because I needed to add another book to my collection. Mm-hmm. But my goal is to try and at least maybe do a series where I just narrate the Bibles, because you know you don't really see anyone else doing that. And there's a lot of you know useful information in there that most people don't know about. So I don't know. I guess I don't really have the voice for narration, though. So I apologize about that.
No, you definitely have the voice for narration. Don't ever think that. Because all right, I'm looking at it right now. So the Satanic Narratives, a Modern Satanic Bible, is a foundational text thoroughly deconstructing Satan, the adversarial archetype, and the individualism of the left-hand path. This updated Satanic Bible marks a reformation in the religion of Satanism, accessible to the average reader and philosopher alike. Satanists who struggle to find meaning in LaVey's Rand-inspired social Darwinism will embrace this new focus on activism in social justice. While the skepticism in circular ethics mirrored that of humanism, this satanic philosophy goes much further, incorporating rebellion, unrelenting perseverance, being the outcast, the individualist, and the adversary. The characteristic of each aspect of Satan, of the Satan archetype, are meticulously explained and linked to the philosophy presented. This not only justifies why it is worthy of the name Satanism, but also answers the question of why it can only be called Satanism.
Pretty interesting, right?
That is like I want to buy.
Yeah, it's a pretty short book. I mean, if you're like heavily committed into it, you could probably read the whole thing in like maybe an hour and a half, maybe 2 hours.
Oh, totally! It's only $10, dude.
Yep. it literally came like 2 days after. I didn't even order it off of Amazon. I just ordered it like off of like one of these back end websites.
And it came all quick. That's awesome.
Yep, within 2 days. So, I do notice that Amazon does bundle it though. So if you do buy the Satanic Bible, 9 times out of 10, Amazon is going to recommend you buy the Satanic Narratives and the Satanic Companion Book or the Satanic Practice.
Yeah, those are the two that were right here. Oh. On Amazon, I'm looking at Amazon right now, and you're absolutely right.
Damien must be so happy about that. But another priest that I have to speak about is I'm not sure if you saw my interview with Aria de Mezzo.
No, I haven't seen that yet.
Well, basically, her story is she's a satanic priestess, founder of the Reformed Satanic Church, and she was running for sheriff in Keene, New Hampshire. Now, she ran as a Republican because the Republican that was supposed to be on the ballot, he had dropped out because of cancer treatment. So she won that election because all these Republicans just voted for her without even knowing who she was. And then they found out that she was both a Satanist and that she was transgender as well. So a lot of them had buyer's remorse and were like, oh, my gosh, I can't believe we elected this woman. And then shortly after that, once she won that nomination, she went up against Eli Rivera. And here's the funny thing. The Republican Party in New Hampshire literally worked with the Democratic Party to try and defeat Aria de Mezzo. And unfortunately, she was defeated by Eli Rivera, the Democrat. So literally, the Republicans worked with the Democrat to defeat their own candidate. Funny, huh?
That was after the fact.
Yep. After they realized they voted her in without noticing. But yeah, back to the whole thing about the Reformed Satanic Church. I don't think she has any, you know, holy books as I know it, but if she, I'll contact her and see if she does plan on writing any, but if she does, I'd be the first to read and review it.
So what exactly did she do as far as, like, you said she does the Reformed Church, so what's the definition of the Reformed Church?
Well, from the way she describes it, it's basically an anti-war type thing. She doesn't like the fact that a lot of our tax money is being used to, you know, fund wars in the Middle East and fund wars all throughout the world. You know, drone strikes, sending troops here and there and whatnot. And her whole thing is to try and disrupt the whole war machine. So she's like a big advocate for, you know, Bitcoin, a big advocate for, you know, smaller government, things like that. It's actually really relatable. She made a lot of good points. I mean, the only thing I disagree with her on is the mask mandate. She believes that mask mandates are a overstep of the government, but I'm like, it's scientifically proven that masks work, but her whole thing is more about liberty rather than, you know, controlling the way people behave.
But that also, that, I mean, that is kind of really courteous, like, just to wear a mask. Like, well, yeah, what if your breath smells?
You'd be surprised at how many crazy anti-maskers are here in New Jersey too. Like, I mean, there was this woman. I think it was up in it was in the same town that D was from. There was a woman that told someone else to put a mask on, and she ended up getting punched in the face. It's crazy. Yeah. It was an elderly. Like, why would you punch an elderly woman just because she told you to put a mask on? Makes no sense. I just really hope that this thing is done and over with, because from what I heard, once we progress truly into winter, things are going to get a lot worse. Apparently, from what I understand, 70% of all independent musicians say that the COVID pandemic has threatened them financially, and we're already seeing the effects of that with all the venues closing, with certain bands, you know, breaking up, not being able to, you know, afford studio time.
Dude, yeah, and band artists fucking ODing and shit, like,
because
they're
yes, because of the whole loneliness, because they can't, you know, speak to any other band members in practice. A lot of them are, you know, going through depression, substance abuse. Domestic abuse too. So yeah. it's really bad. I really hope that this doesn't cripple the scene.
Yeah, definitely. I don't want to say anything because I don't want to jinx it, but I feel like, yeah, once everything does open up again, like, I'm hoping for like a boom, you know, like a boom of everything back, you know, like backyard gigs happening all the fucking time again. The smaller clubs and bars having shows in like their parking lots and whatnot, you know, because they already cleared area, you know, for like, that's a lot of businesses did. They cleared areas for like, you know, outdoor dining and everything. Like, what if they just kept it there and had fucking bands play and everything, like, just to get more people in?
That's what I want to see more of, you know.
Really what I'm hoping for, is that, like, yeah, once all this is done, dude, like, yeah, like, fuck it, it's just, like, fucking those big gigs at the, like, at the Coliseum and the Rose Bowl and the new stadiums they built, like, they get all fucking crazy and wild again, you know?
Yep, crowd surfing, moshing, slam dancing, all that.
Yeah.
I'm more concerned about, like the local scenes, too, because, you know, those are the artists that have, I guess you could say, a lot of the talent, a lot of the things that you don't really see from mainstream metal bands and mainstream punk artists. You know, they're the ones that are willing to experiment, try new things out. Like Neon Funeral. I mean, how many metal bands do you know that incorporate synthwave and mix it in with metal? You don't really hear about that often. That was like my first time hearing that.
Yeah, man. And like the stuff, the bands that are still together and cooking and everything, like the shit that they're coming out with now is it's hard, dude. It's hard and it's good. And like, that's what I'm saying. Like the talent is there, man. Like a lot of these bands and everything, they're ready just to fucking knock it off. And I'm sure once everything opens again, like that's exactly what they're going to do. Get as many gigs as they can and as many people out, man, because everybody's been inside for too long.
Yep. I have a feeling this summer is going to be pretty wild. It's going to be a really busy summer.
Yeah, I think so too.
That's when they say that things are going to start reopening again anyway, between spring and summer. So I'm saving up as much cash as I can. Once the concert tickets start going back on sale, then that's...
Well, I bought a whole bunch when everything got shut down, so I'm like, I still have them. I'm still held on to them and everything, so...
Oh.
Yeah, once everything gets rescheduled, man, I'm there. It's funny that you mentioned Scribble Dude, because he was the one that was like, oh, dude, if you get a floor ticket to System, I might get you backstage. So I bought a floor ticket to System, and... But now I don't even know if Korn's going to be playing. So I had a ticket to Korn, System, and Faith No More. So
good lineup too.
What happened?
I said that's a good lineup too.
Yeah, yeah, exactly, dude. It was going to be a great show, and I was like, should I get a seat or just or get a floor ticket, whatever. But because Korn is playing, he has a connection that will let us get backstage. But now I don't even.
That is exciting though.
Yeah, dude, I was fucking stoked, man. It was like this year, and then I have then there's Megadeth and Lamb of God. They're going on tour again, and then Testament with Black Dahlia and Municipal Waste. Like
that's one. Now that's a show I definitely need to go to. I mean, Megadeth, Lamb of God, Municipal Waste, Black.
Black Dahlia,
four of like my top 20 favorite metal bands, and then threw them all in one show.
Yeah, dude, I fucking. This year was going to be such a great year for shows and everything, and so I'm excited, man. Once everything starts getting back together and opening up, man, I'm already there. I'm there for sure.
So any local pubs in your area or
no?
Holy snap! Is that D Rotten?
Yep,
D Rotten. What's up, D?
He's alive. He probably just woke up from a weed nap.
Oh, weed naps, aren't they the best?
That motherfucker, dude. It's a. we were supposed to do a show, and I was already kind of late. And what did I just tell you, dude? What did I say? I called it.
Yep, just woke up.
But yeah, we were supposed to do a show and everything, and like I was already late, so I can't really be that mad. So I told him, I was like, something's come up, I'll be back and I'll let you know. So I hit him up and he's like, oh, I'm at Walmart right now. The line is super long and I don't think I'm going to get out of here for a while. And I was like, okay, so how long? And he was like, 6 o'clock, your time. So it was like, 3 o'clock here. Motherfucker didn't hit me up until 6 o'clock my time. And as a matter of
fact, that's hilarious.
Yeah. And as a matter of fact, he didn't hit me up. I had to text him and be like, yo, are we doing this? Like, it's fucking 9 o'clock where you're at. Like, are we going to get started or what? And then he texts me back like, dude, I just smoked a big old bowl. And I just woke up from a weed nap. And I was like, oh, Jesus.
Oh, man.
Dude. So, yeah, I totally believe it. He's awake. He's in now. We got two people watching, man.
Dude, pretty good.
Yeah, man. The last couple episodes, I had about 5 viewers, the entire time, all throughout the entire show.
That's actually, to be honest, 5 is a lot better than what I even get when I try to do live streams.
Yeah, but like, you use later on, like that's it. Like I usually get those 5, and then maybe a few more after that. Like I'm only in the 100 still on YouTube views and all that shit, even on Facebook. And Facebook is like my biggest market, man.
Yeah, because when you share something on Facebook, people are going to like continuously share it if they like the content that's out there. That's one of the things that I noticed.
Yeah.
So like I noticed I was getting lots of views. I'm like, why am I getting so many more views on Facebook than on YouTube? It's because people are sharing it and people are watching it. Now, they might not watch the whole thing, but if you watch like 1 or 2 minutes of it, you kind of, you know, get the gist of what's going on. And then they're going to like it. Then they're going to, you know, man, this is crazy. I didn't know you guys are going to be on tonight.
Huh. Dude, I told you, D, man. I'm fucking locking them in, man. I got shit in my back pocket all the time.
But I also I think Twitter has helped out Famcast a lot, too, because, you know, I notice a lot of people are retweeting us the stuff that D's posting. A lot of people are retweeting, you know, Humpcast stuff.
Yeah.
I'm going to be like a little I guess you could say critical here, but it's kind of hard to, you know, retweet a lot of the Rat Talk stuff, because every time I try to retweet it, it says these tweets, it says Rat Matt the Rat can't be retweeted, can't be tagged in this tweet. And I'm like, why is it doing that? I'm like, maybe I don't know if my account is suspended or if there's restrictions put on the account, but every time I try to tag you in like a certain post,
it's private though.
So it's privated.
Yeah, I think.
My bad.
I didn't even realize that, but yeah, I'll fix that shit.
I mean, if it's privated for like jobs and whatnot, then I don't blame you.
No, actually, man, that's one thing cool about my job is that they don't really care for that shit. Don't look at it. Well, I mean, they care, but they don't really look at it. They don't seek it out.
Oh. Yeah, that's a relief.
Yeah, I was gonna go into that, but actually, I shouldn't. My job's cool, man. That's all I'll leave it at. Shit, I totally lost my train of thought right now.
Yeah, the liquor is starting to get to me already. Damn, I didn't even realize how much fucking peanut butter I drank.
All right, well, what's the future looking like for Satanic Panic, man? Like, are you just gonna keep doing what you're doing? How's
everything? I'm going to, for the most part, just continue doing what I'm doing. You know, answering questions about Satanism. Still continue, you know, to speak about. Well, there's actually a lot more stuff I'm planning on doing in the future. There's certain artists that I'm working with. As you can see, I put 2 beats that I made onto my channel. And that was basically done as a test, because, you know, there's certain independent artists, you know, local artists, you know, bands and, you know, rappers and stuff like that, that want me to produce music for them. I have one artist that I'm working with out of Kentucky. I'm gonna give her a shout out. Her name is the Goddess 444 on Twitter. She's I guess you can say, a pop slash witch pop singer. She believes in, I think, a religion called atheism, and she wants me to produce, you know, beats for her. Now, one of the songs that she was covering was a Tyra Banks song, so that's what I'm working on with her right now. I had the instrumental all done. I sent that to her. Just got to wait for her to record the vocals. And I said, as soon as her album drops, I'm going to review it on Satanic Panic and give her some exposure. And also, I do have like a few, I guess you could say, alternative type rappers, like none of the rah-rah crap that you hear on the radio. Like, this is all independent, creative, original work. So I said, you know what? If I like it, I'm going to review it. I'm going to give you guys as much exposure as possible. And, you know, just going to critique it. If there's something I don't like, I'll let you know. If there's something I really like, I'm going to put that front, first, and center. But yeah, I've been sharing some of my independent music, my beats. Do plan on doing some covers myself. I mean, I have enough equipment now. Got the new keyboard right here. I got the old one sitting over in the corner off camera. And then I have like the fucking my banjo over here, so you can get some really cool sounds when you connect a banjo to a fucking cabinet. So see how that sounds. Do a few playthroughs, covers.
Well, shit, how long have you been playing, man?
To be honest, on and off since high school. Like, my first band that I was in, it was called, you're going to laugh when I tell you this, it was called PBC, Purebred Children. But we just kept the acronym as PBC, and then we just wrote the word hair afterwards. So it was called PBC Hair. We would sing about all sorts of things. I started off with bass in that band, and I was playing the bass and rapping all at the same time. When we do live shows, we would sometimes have volunteers from the audience, and they would be like, "Oh, rap about food," or "Rap about, you know, orange juice," or something like that. And then one of us would play a beat. The drummer would beat a drum, and I would just play a random melody. And then one person would start rapping. Then they would pass the mic to the next person. Then they would pass the mic to the next person. It was fun. Yeah, I haven't done anything like that for quite some time now.
Yeah, this is what Dee posted. But actually, it was really funny. He had to specify. Yep.
I think there's only two live clips of that show. If they're still on YouTube, they might have gotten deleted. But if they're still around, then I will repost them.
But yeah, pubic hair, dude. That's what we're looking for.
Because I'm like, it adds comedy. When people hear that and see the name, they're gonna start laughing.
Now, honestly, like, you could just be like, "Oh, we're Purebred Children," you know, and like that's all it is. And so when they Google it and everything, they put pure. But what pops up is PBC Hair. Yep.
and also another reason why we added the hair is because we all had like crazy hairstyles back then. Like, through like I think the entire 4 years I was in high school, I had a fade. Now, my senior year, right before I went to prom, I'm like, you know what? I'm going to modify the fade. Instead of having a fade, I'm going to wear a Gumby. You ever you know how DJ Jazzy Jeff had it in The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air? How it like slants down on the side? That's how I had it.
Oh, shit.
Or like Bobby Brown. And then you see me all bald, and I'm like, what happened to all the hair? Well, I guess you can say age kicked in. 26 hit me hard. I started getting all like gray and whatnot. And then I guess you can say I've been used to being bald so long that when I grow hair, it just gets all itchy. So I'm like, all right, screw it. I might as well just take the razor blade, shave it all off, and it might stay like this permanently for the rest of my life.
Dude, I just turned 27, and I'm fucking battling it too on the top of my head. That line was not there last year.
The part?
Yeah. Yeah, it wasn't that bad, man. Mm-hmm. So I know what you mean, man.
I'm surprised my head got all salt and peppery so fast, because I was literally like all black like last year. And then this, not last year, the year before, I was all black. And then I start seeing patches of gray here, patches of gray in the front, patches, a whole bunch of gray in the back. I'm like, oh no, I don't know what's going on with me. Looking like fucking Gandalf the Gray.
Wait, I was going to say, wait, so you could grow your hair, it's just gray?
Say what?
You could grow your hair, but it's just gray? Is that what you're saying?
Like it's like all gray in the back, and then like certain patches of gray up on the top and the sides. But I think the thing that bothers me about hair growth the most is that it just gets so itchy all of a sudden. So,
dude, that's not even that bad, man. Going bald is so much worse.
No, I've gotten compliments on being bald. I mean, you have to understand. It's gonna be funny, but Anton LaVey was bald, so.
Oh shit! It's so funny. Like, I didn't expect you to be, because I usually see you with your hats on and everything. You got some sort of hat on or something covering your head.
Yeah, I literally just did another fresh shave today, so I'm like, wait for all the oils and the coconut oil and the sheen to, you know, soak into my scalp.
And you get a real nice shine right there on top, dude.
I just wish it stayed this shiny. Watch. In two more days, my hair is going to grow back. So,
shit.
It grows back so fast. It's a shame, because I've been trying to get my facial hair to grow, and it just doesn't grow. So I'm like, all right, guess I'm stuck with this goatee.
Hey, story of my life, dude. This isn't even shade that's on the side of my cheek. It's hair. It just makes it my jawline look a little more shady on camera.
No, it's shade's pretty nice. Like mine's grows in patches. Like it'll grow thick on one side, and then on the other side it'll grow thick in certain parts, and then like short in other parts. No, and I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna just wait for it to grow in, and it would never grow in. The thick parts would keep getting thicker, and the short parts just wouldn't grow at all. So I'm like, all right, I guess I wasn't meant to have a full beard. So
what I'm battling with right now. I don't have. Yeah, I can't grow a full beard either, man. Story of my life.
And the thing is, I tried everything: beard balms and hair growth formula. Nah. I think I did manage to grow a beard like earlier this year, but it went bad pretty fast, because one side just grew, this side grew all long and this side just stayed the same.
Oh shit. You had a crooked beard. It looked like
it looks so weird.
It looked like your hair when you styled it. It was all fucking slanted one way. You had a beard going the other way.
Oh man.
All right, man. Well, I think this is a good time to end it, dude. This is a fucking honor. This was great to have you on.
Hey, I enjoyed it.
Yeah.
We need to get together like this a lot more often, do a lot more, because I'm usually off on Mondays and Wednesdays, so.
Oh, perfect. Yep, that's perfect.
But who knows? My schedule might change, because like I said, I'm planning on, you know, putting in my resignation at my other job, so I don't know what new job in my new schedule is going to be. But I'll keep you guys updated on that.
Yeah, definitely. Let us know, because we would love to see more of you. More of you and us getting together like this. We're gonna do another holiday special soon. I was thinking Valentine's Day. We'll do another one.
Perfect. Valentine's Day is a good holiday.
Yeah, exactly. So
I call it SAD, Single Awareness Day, because I'm single. But I don't mind it, because I'm polyamorous too, so
it's perfect. It's a good holiday that we should go. We'll definitely plan that out, man. All right, I'm gonna take it out on a song by a band that I was actually getting really into right before quarantine hit and all of that. Oh wait, hold on, we got one last message from
Embrace the Grays, Embrace the Receding Hairline, Just Call It Getting Cooler. Yeah.
That's a good positive.
That's a good outlook on it.
Yeah.
I can co-sign to that.
All right, man. It was good to fucking see you. It was good to fucking do this. Thank you all for tuning in. We're going to take it on a band called Yesterday's Donuts, called Play Pretend. Do you want to plug anything else before we let it all go?
If you guys want to know more, I'll be doing a show with Scribble Wednesday night at 9 o'clock, and we'll be discussing the top 10 best Immortal songs of all time. I'm going to be listing my personal favorites, and he's going to be listing his. So anyone wants to tune in on that, we're going to be live at 9 o'clock.
Fuck yeah, dude. There it is. Scribble. He's got a big
it's gonna be my first time on Psychohood Blowout, so let's see how it goes.
There you go, man. All right, dude. Well, thank you so much for being on the show. I appreciate it. I hope everything goes according to plan, of course. Stay safe out there, brother.
All right, thank you so much for inviting me. It was a pleasure. Hail Satan.
Hail Satan, motherfuckers. All right, guys, we're gonna take it out. Yesterday's Donuts, Play Pretend.
Out of character, trading tears for laughter.
Can't tell what is real or fake. Why not take another take? Hit it just as much as you do. But this is what it's come to. As long as we play our cards right, sleep in different beds at night, then everything should be alright.
Let's pretend that we're in love, even though we're tired of keeping up this endless picture. All we really gotta do is to say, I love you, I love you. Let's pretend that we're in love, even though we're tired of keeping up this endless picture. All we really gotta do is to say, I love you, I love you.